Today we're taking a look on a vehicle we've covered on this channel already, the light tank M3, or Stuart. While this vehicle's history with the US military and its development have been well covered, we return to this vehicle here today to cover an interesting piece of equipment attached to it. Here at the rear of our Stuart, we find what is basically the lower half of a deep water fording stack. So what is this exactly? What does it do? How is it installed? And does it even work? Before getting into the wartime technical details of this piece of equipment, let's briefly define what deep water fording is. Deep fording capability, according to the Department of Defense, is quoted as the ability of a self-propelled gun or ground vehicle equipped with built-in waterproofing and/or special waterproofing kits to negotiate a water obstacle with its wheels or tracks in contact with the ground. Interestingly enough, fording is properly defined as a crossing a body of water at its shallowest point. That said, fording kits allow vehicles to cross bodies of water that otherwise may partially submerge or waterlog them, making them capable of deep fording. Such maneuvers are useful in crossing rivers or deploying during amphibious landing far away from the beach. But again, without proper procedures and equipment, water can not only leak into a vehicle, it can drown the engine. Fording equipment kits, like the one we are about to talk about, not only make the vehicle's hull somewhat watertight, but they also include chimney-like things called stacks by the US military. Stacks are designed to stick out above the water, so like a human snorkel, the vehicle has a way to breathe, so to speak. All fording kits would include at least one stack, or pipe as they're called on wheeled vehicles, that funnel exhaust upwards so that the exhaust pipe itself isn't exposed to the water. Some fording kits, though, like those designed for the M4 Sherman, feature an additional stack that allowed the vehicle's air intake to remain functional. The tank could then cool its engine without risk of taking on water. Remember, most American tanks during this time period had air-cooled engines. It should be noted that fording kit tanks are not the same as DD or duplex drive tanks. Fording kits allow a vehicle to cross through deeper water while keeping in contact with the ground, while duplex drive tanks are fully amphibious. Before we can use the M3 Stuart for fording operations, we must prepare the tank and the deep water fording kits for usage. This information comes from TM9-2853, published in July of 1945. This isn't just one kit, but two separate kits. The first kit waterproofs the vehicle, while the second kit adds the stacks that we previously mentioned. The goal of this is to operate the tank properly for a period of 8 minutes in water up to 6 feet in depth. The documents cover the kits and preparations of deep water fording on vehicles ranging from tanks to trucks. Before the vehicle is fully prepared for deep water fording, a multi-step process needs to take place. First, you must completely seal off the vehicle, top to bottom, back to front. The TM instructs that you must spray the engine with an ignition insulation compound, including the electrical components and spark plugs. This compound waterproofs everything in the engine bay. Just don't spray it on the cooling fans, as the TM states. Next, the hull must be made watertight. Tape and sealing compounds are used to fill all cracks and joints of the vehicle, from the rivets, bolts, sponsons, bogey brackets, transmission covers, undercarriage, and everything else in between. Even the gun barrel needs to be properly sealed with tape, which, as per the TM, could be conveniently removed by firing an armored piercing or smoke shell. However, the exact procedure for waterproofing varies by the last structural analysis of the hull, the modifications, and any individual peculiarities with that specific vehicle. In the case of the example we're quoting here, that means either an M3 or M5 light tank. While there are important notes to follow in the procedure, it comes down to knowing your vehicle. When in doubt, seal it out. In the case of the sealing compound, it would be painted on with a brush. Moving firmly in circular rotations, you would cover all these parts of the vehicle in a good amount of sealing compound. The circular movement was particularly important for getting a good seal. Asbestos grease was also used in large quantities. Nearly every part of the vehicle, where heat was not encountered, was covered in the grease as a sealing compound. Some examples include the turret ring, crew hatches, and lights. Now, if you've been paying some attention to the photos we've shown of the TM, you may notice that our fording kit looks a little bit different than the one shown. That's because our fording kit here is not American, but rather British. There are a few key differences between the American and British variants. One that you can't see here is the addition of a front intake stack. The American version lacks this intake, as the engine deck would be covered with a greased tarp. Yes, this does mean that the engine was in danger of overheating. But remember, as per the TM, the American method only needs to keep the engine running for up to 8 minutes. At the rear of our vehicle, we have the bottom part of the stack assembly. However, there are a few differences that we can see. First, unlike the American version, the exhaust pan and adapter are welded, not bolted together. Second, the rear emergency door on the pan is a lot larger, covering the entirety of the plate. Removing this gave crews access to the engine bay. The American version's door is simply much smaller. Third, there are 3 mounting brackets on the British version compared to the 2 seen on the American one. Latches on either side of the adapter allowed the rest of the stack to properly be mounted and also to be jettisoned once the vehicle reached dry land. A simple pull of the cord and the latches would disengage, dropping off the stack. Of course, we know many Stuarts were sent to the British via the Lend-Lease program. Overseas, the vehicle became known as the Honey. As such, the M3 was used in a variety of British units, and so it's only natural that the A2 used fording kits. That said, there unfortunately isn't any way to tell who or where our M3 served with. Work on the vehicle, ironically, has removed most of the features we could use to research further. Both the turret and the rear storage boxes are reproduction. Now, amidst the reproduction items on our Stuart, we also feature some non-original items, including its engine. Your standard Stuart would have an air-cooled radial engine. This obviously does not have that. It has a water-cooled engine, which is unoriginal to the Stuart. It's ironic, and perhaps a miracle, that despite all this work done, the vehicle retained the rarest part of it, its fording kit. There are obviously a lot of examples of American Stuarts mounting the deepwater fording kits that we talked about in the beginning of this video. In various footage, you can see Stuarts, both with and without fording kits, driving right out of LSTs onto the beach itself. This isn't exactly fording. The deepwater fording kit for the M3 Stuart was made for the vehicle to navigate through much deeper water than what its maximum fording depth typically was, which was typically around 36 inches, without risking damage to its engine, other internal components, or most importantly, the crew. While the fording kit seems practical, it's actually up for debate. In a lot of footage of D-Day, you can watch tanks with deep fording kits installed drive out of LSTs without ever needing to use a system. The long process to install these kits and waterproof the tanks as per the TM, the tedious procedures that follow, along with footage showing that these kits weren't always required during amphibious landings, prompts the question, were they ever needed? We see attempts to use tanks in amphibious landings via fording on several occasions, from the Dieppe raid to D-Day Normandy. Whether they were actually effective or not, the story of the fording kits and the M3 Stuart is an interesting one, at least to me.